In this video, we're going to talk about raising and lowering tensor indexes. And just a reminder, I'm using non-standard tensor product notation in this video. Your textbooks will write the tensor product like this. I'm going to write it like this. So at this point, we're pretty familiar with the vector spaces V and V star. V is where vectors live, and V star is the dual space where the corresponding covectors live. So one question we can ask is there any way that we can create a correspondence between the vectors of V and the covectors of V star? In other words, is there any meaningful way that we can take a vector in V and find its partner in V star? Well, one way we could create a correspondence would be to take the basis vector EI in V and pair it up with the basis covector epsilon I in V star. So right off the bat, we're able to assign covector partners for all the basis vectors. So this works in two dimensions, as you can see here, but it also works no matter what the dimension of the space is. And if we want to find the covector partner of any arbitrary vector V, we can expand it as a linear combination of basis vectors, turn the basis vectors into basis covectors, and we can say that the covector, which is equal to this linear combination, is that vector's partner in V star. So this seems nice at first, but there's actually a problem with this approach. And to see why, let's consider a change of basis. So let's say we change to a new basis by multiplying all the old basis vectors by 2. So we have our old basis, and we're basically making all the vectors twice as big to get to the new basis. And this is essentially using a forward transform where we have 2s along the diagonals and 0s everywhere else. And of course, the backward transform would be the opposite, multiplying all the vectors by 1/2. So the backward transform has 1/2 along the diagonal and 0s everywhere else. Now the problem with that is that while basis vectors are covariant, so that when we go from the old basis to the new basis, we transform the basis vectors using the forward transform, but with basis covectors are contravariant, so that when we go from the old basis to the new basis, we use the backward coefficients. And that means to get the new basis of covectors, we would multiply the old covector basis by 1/2. So this method of assigning partners doesn't work very well, because while the correspondence might look nice in one basis, it starts to look weird and ugly in another choice of basis. Right? The coefficients here don't match up very well. Okay, so we need to try again, and this time we need to try avoiding using a basis at all. Introducing a basis is what made things ugly in the first place. So here's what I'll propose. We have a vector V in our vector space, and to get its partner covector, we introduce the covector v dot something, where this something is just an input slot for another vector to go in. And you might be wondering, is this really a member of v star? Is this thing really a covector? And it turns out, yes it is. First of all, this is obviously a function from our vector space v to a scalar, because if we supply a vector here, the dot product of two vectors produces a number. So v dot something is a function that takes a vector and produces a number. But the members of v star can't just be any old function from vectors to scalars, right? They also have to be linear. So we can use the properties of the dot product to show that this function is linear. For example, if we put in the input vector a, scaled by some number n, we're free to take this n out and put it in front like this. So this shows that we can either scale the input or scale the output and get the same result. Also, if we have a sum of vectors in the input, the dot product is distributive, so we can distribute this v over the dot product and get this sum here. So basically, we can add the inputs or add the outputs. So we've proven these two properties here, so this means that the function v dot something is linear. And that means that it really is a member of v star, so v dot something really is a covector. It's a function from vectors to scalars, and it also obeys linearity rules where we can add or scale the inputs or add or scale the outputs, just like we would expect with normal covectors. So the first correspondence that we came up with was kind of ugly. The vector covector partners might look nice in one basis, but a change of basis makes things ugly because growing the vectors causes the covectors to shrink. And this breaks the rule of establishing partners by replacing basis vectors with basis covectors. On the other hand, this new correspondence that we came up with, where we partner the vector v with the covector v dot something, doesn't depend on a basis at all, and so we don't run into any problems when we change basis. Moreover, when we scale the vector by 2, we also scale its covector partner by 2, so the vectors and their covector partners will always grow and shrink by the same amount. Okay, so if v dot something really lives in the vector space v star, that means that we should be able to build it out of basis covectors, right? So what are the components of v dot something? What are the x coefficients here that we can use to build it as a linear combination of the epsilon covectors? So to figure that out, recall that the result of the dot product of vectors v and w is given by passing the vectors to the metric tensor g. And remember, to compute the output of this, what we do is we just expand the metric tensor and both vectors as linear combinations. And now we're going to pass these vectors to these covectors like this. And it actually doesn't matter what order we pass them in. We could do it this way, or we could do it the other way. And the reason the order doesn't matter is because the metric tensor is symmetric, and the order of the inputs doesn't matter. We get the same result either way. So we can bring these coefficients out in front, and we can rewrite these as Kronecker deltas, and now using the index cancellation rule, we get this. And this is the familiar summation formula we use to get the output of the metric tensor. Now, to get the components of v dot something, we'll just do the exact same thing again, except we're going to pass a single vector v to the metric tensor as the input, and leave the second input slot empty. So we expand g and v out as linear combinations, and I can pass this vector ej to one of these covectors. It doesn't matter which, because the metric tensor is symmetric. I'm just going to pass it to this one here. So I'm going to take the coefficient out in front and pass ej to epsilon k here, and that gives us a Kronecker delta, so we can cancel out these indexes, and there we go. These are the components of v dot something in the epsilon basis. And we could also go through this same process again in another basis, and we would get that the components of v dot something in the epsilon tilde basis are these components right here. Okay, so we know how to get the components of the covector v dot something. So as an alternative notation, rather than writing g with downstairs indexes and v with an upstairs index, I'm just going to write v with a downstairs index. So with this notation here, it's almost as if the metric tensor components are lowering the index of the components of v to give the covector components of v dot something. And the same thing can be done in any basis. So in summary, a vector v can be written like this with the upstairs versions of the v components, and its partner covector v dot something can be written like this with the downstairs versions of the v components. And the way we convert between the upstairs and downstairs versions of v is by doing a summation with the metric tensor components. And I just want to clarify this because this is really important. V with downstairs components and v with upstairs components are not the same thing, okay? They are not equal. If we want to switch between them, we have to use the metric tensor components and do a summation. The only way that this equality is true is in the extremely special case where the metric tensor components are given by the Kronecker delta. And that's the extremely special case of an orthonormal coordinate system. Okay, so we found a way to partner up vectors and covectors, and we've done that by pairing the vector v with the covector v dot something. And the way we get from the vector to the covector is by using the metric tensor. We normally think of the metric tensor as a function from a pair of vectors to scalars, but we could also think of it as a function from a single vector in v to a covector in v star. Now you might ask, what about the reverse direction? How do we get from a covector to its vector partner? Well, we know all about the metric tensor now. We know its components have two lower indexes, so it's a member of v star tensor v star. And now I'm going to introduce what's called the inverse metric tensor, which is sort of like the opposite of the metric tensor, and it lives in v tensor v. And the inverse metric tensor is defined so that when combined with the ordinary metric tensor in a summation, we get the Kronecker delta as a result. So this is by definition, this is how we define the inverse metric tensor. And we see that if we take the standard index lowering equation and multiply on both sides by the inverse metric tensor, then these will cancel out and give a Kronecker delta, and then we use the index cancellation rule and get this. Okay, so the ordinary metric tensor lowers indexes, but the inverse metric tensor goes in the other direction and raises indexes. And of course, we could also make this same definition in any other coordinate system and get similar results. So going from vectors to covectors, we use the ordinary metric tensor, or sometimes called the covariant metric tensor because its components are covariant. And going in the other direction, from covectors to vectors, we use the inverse metric tensor, which is sometimes called the contravariant metric tensor because its components are contravariant. So we know about the components of the vector v, we know about the components of the covector v dot something, we know about the definition of the inverse metric tensor, and we know that the ordinary metric tensor lowers indexes while the inverse metric tensor raises indexes. Now, these raising and lowering operations don't just apply to vector and covector components. We can also raise and lower the indexes on the components of other tensors too. So take this tensor Q, which is a member of V tensor V star tensor V star, which has these components here. And if we multiply by the inverse metric tensor and sum over J like this, then we can raise the index upward. And we get this new tensor Q prime, which is a member of V tensor V tensor V star. Notice how this V star up here in the middle has been changed to a V down here. And that corresponds with the raising of the middle index. And likewise with the tensor D, which is a member of V tensor V, we can take these components and use the ordinary metric tensor to lower the A indexes, and we get the components of a new tensor D prime, which is a member of V star tensor V. So it turns out that raising and lowering indexes can be done on the components of any tensor. So all these vector spaces on this slide can be traveled between using the ordinary metric tensor to lower indexes, which means we travel in the direction of the blue arrow, or we can use the inverse metric tensor to raise indexes, which here corresponds to going in the direction of the red arrow. The last thing I'm going to mention is an alternate notation for converting between vector and covector partners. So we know that this covector v dot something is also equal to the metric tensor with just one input slot filled with the vector v. And an alternative notation for writing this covector is like this, v flat, where the symbol for this flat operator is the flat symbol you might recognize from music. So the upstairs V components are the components of the vector V, but the downstairs V components are the components of the covector V flat. So the flat operator basically lowers the indexes, and that makes sense because the flat symbol in music will lower the pitch of a note by 1/2 step, like we have here from B to B flat. The flat gives it a lower pitch. Also, if you think about it, the flat operator is transforming a vector arrow, which is kind of pointy, into a covector stack, which is nice and flat. So you can think of this as flattening the pointy arrow into a flat stack. On the other hand, if we have a covector alpha defined like this, as a vector A dot something, which, by the way, this is the same thing as the inverse metric tensor taking the covector alpha in the first input slot, we can go from the covector alpha to the vector A using the sharp operator. So the covector alpha has components with downstairs indexes, and the vector alpha sharp has components with upstairs indexes. So the sharp operator is basically raising the index. And that makes sense too, because in music, the sharp symbol raises the pitch of a note by 1/2 step, like we have here from F to F sharp. Also, the sharp operator is basically turning a flat covector stack into a sharp pointy arrow vector. So the sharp and flat symbols, they're maybe a little bit silly, but I think they fit these operations really well, And they also correspond to turning sharp vectors into flat covectors and flat covectors into sharp vectors. So to sum everything up, we created vector-covector partners by partnering vector v with v dot something. The vector component index goes upstairs on the vector and goes downstairs on the covector. We also learned the definition of the inverse metric tensor, and we know how the ordinary and inverse metric tensors can help us lower and raise indexes, respectively. And not only can this operation be used on vector and covector components, these operations can also be used on tensors of any size. And finally, we learned the notation for the flat and sharp operators for converting between vector and covector partners.